I am so excited to share my friend and colleague Adaora Udoji with you all here today. That's why she's in this program. Adaora runs the corporate innovation at RLab, and I wanted to also bring her here to share what's going on at RLab. How many of you have heard of RLab? Anyone?
Okay.
All right. So Adaora really comes from a place of innovation. She's been involved in media and storytelling really from an innovative perspective for many years before she got to her RLab position. And I think that part of her bio is super interesting for what she's doing at RLab. So I'll also share with you, there's a slide here we have that will lay out, I'm hoping we can have that slide, there we go, that lays out a little bit of what she's working on. But anyway, here is Adaora, and thank you so much for coming, Adaora, and being here with us today.
No, thank you, Dawn. Thank you. And thank you for Creative Tech Week. And I also have to say congratulations for the mere fact that I've been at an event in the title, it says tech, and this morning I've seen women on the stage, women of color on the stage, a good Hello. Mix of diversity and thought. So thank you.
Thank you.
Isn't it amazing, Noelle? We exist, these women of color in tech.
Yep. So important to Isabel from the beginning and for me and I know for you. Yeah, we've been doing this for 3 years now. This is the fourth year. And, you know, super important to Isabel to get all the people, right?
All the people.
And so anyway, I'm not gonna talk about RLab. I want you to. Some of you know what it is. It's super important to me as a New York City person, as a New York City technology community person, that this started here in New York. So RLab is actually the first city-funded, city-backed center of its kind to focus on augmented reality, AI. VR, all the stuff. So I'll let you describe that a little bit before we.
Absolutely. RLab is funded by the New York City Economic Development Corporation and the Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment. And I liken it, the best metaphor that I can come up with is about 10 years ago, if somebody said, I'm going to go build a social media team, most people would be like, what are you talking about? And we're sort of there when it comes to immersive tech, and it's a very broad bucket of technologies. I mean, we've heard a lot about AI this morning, but ultimately we're talking about a convergence of technology, right? Which is, you have all of these, I liken it as a huge refrigerator where you have all of these technical components, whether you're talking about advanced algorithms like AI or computer visualization and or LiDAR sensors, and we can go down the list, right? Robotics, et cetera. So we have all of these ingredients and tools that are going to change the way that we access our computing power, right? I mean, how many of you think this is it? We're not going to innovate anymore. We're done, right? Today, this is it. So RLab is focused on those evolving immersive technologies, and most notably, we talk about them as virtual reality or augmented reality. I personally think it's sort of, they're misnomers. They're not, what's important is what they do and how we're going to apply them. And we're learning about that right now. And so we're 17,000 square feet. We're in the Brooklyn Navy Yard. We are focused on, we have three specific mandates. Or I should say we have one mandate and we are attacking it in three different ways. One mandate is to support economic activity and other activity relative to these immersive technologies. And we do that in three different ways. And I want Laura Barker, who's part of the corporate team at RLab, to raise her hand, and Janice Brown, who's next to her, who's part of the educational and training team. We are working on, one, supporting startups, funding and formation, awesome, and projects relative to these emerging technologies. Number two, educational and training programs, a lot of upskilling, so professionals who are interested in learning about motion capture, volumetric, data or cloud processing, all of these highly technical advances that we're experiencing today, as well as non-technical people who want to learn about the future of work and these emerging technology tools and why you should be paying attention even if you don't know anything about C++. All of us don't need to be coders. It's just everyone can't be a coder. Everyone doesn't want to be a coder. But tech literacy is really important as we move into this next evolution of all of these new technologies. And the third bucket, the third leg on our table, is corporate innovation. So we work with corporations, helping them think through what these new technologies mean for them, the kinds of skills that they need internally, the ways that they think about both their employees and getting them up to speed. And then the second bucket is, how do you develop products and services in this open innovation world that we live in?
Cool, super cool. Well, I'm also super excited to have you here at NYIT as who's our partner in Creative Tech Week, so that also, you know, some of the people here who we heard from this morning at the administrative level, but also the professor level and, of course, the student level can, you know, my dream would be for those students to then be some of your RLab people someday. And now I know you're working with a bunch of entities, CUNY and Cornell Tech, and, you know, so describe a little bit about, I just find...
Well, let me just make sure, I don't want there to be any confusion.
Yeah.
We are a consortium of universities, that's NYU, Columbia,
right.
New School, and CUNY, and we are really friendly with all the other schools in New York City.
Right, right. Yeah, and so how, yes, and exactly, and so, you know, how did that part, that's hard to do. I know how hard that is to do. You know, schools tend to often be very siloed. How did it come about, or just how did the whole concept of it come about for our lab? And, you know, particularly on the city side also, not always the first to think about innovation centers.
I love Dawn so much because she's always so humble. I always refer to her as an original gangster techie in New York City because she's been in this game for a very long time. So, yes, you know very well how difficult it is to get all of these various silos to collaborate with one another. I think it's a combination of things, and much of the credit goes to our executive director, Justin Hendricks, who also runs the New York City Media Lab. And about 2.5 years, almost 3 years ago, I was working for a venture firm. And there were people at EDC who came to me and many others in and around New York City and said, listen, we're thinking about funding a center like this. What do you think? And many of us gave our suggestions of, hey, we really think it's a good idea. We see this technology 5, 10, 15 years being critical to the way we evolve, the way we work, and the way that we live. And Justin had been very actively seeking and encouraging and had brought this idea initially to, you know, the university and then to some of the partners that also fund the New York City Media Lab. And ultimately, they decided it was big enough that they had to form an RFP. So they sent out an RFP and they said, we want a center that's going to do all these variety of things and provide educational opportunities and corporate innovation and opportunities, et cetera. And they put a call out, and I believe there were somewhere between a dozen and 20 or so applications, and in the end, this, I think it's somewhere around there, maybe around a dozen-ish, and in the end, the EDC and the mayor's office decided that NYU and Columbia and CUNY and the New School were onto something, and so we got that, and the doors opened in the Brooklyn Navy Yard just at the end of October, so we're very new, and we're crawling and running at the same time, which is painful.
Yeah, but that's also why I wanted Adaora here today to also share with all of you. You know, my vision is that the people who are interested in Creative Tech Week, you here today, really, I want to be the first ones involved in whatever capacity that means. Let me just ask you quickly, Adaora, there's two main questions I have. For one, what would be, in your mind, like one successful product or company that would, what would that look like to you that would come out of our lab? You know, do you have a sense of that? Do you have an idea of what, you know, a dream founder or product would be for coming out?
I think the dream or the way that we're thinking about it now is more about systematically collateralizing all of the efforts that are happening, and particularly all the happenings in New York City, and particularly being able to harness this creative community and this cross-collaboration that exists here in ways like very few other places. I mean, one thing that makes New York so special was sort of KPMG came out I'm sure Janice and Laura over there shaking their head because I've been talking about this study for weeks. But KPMG came out with a survey about a month ago that said, after they talked to Fortune 100 leaders across the all over the world, that said that they see New York City dominating and influencing this next generation of technology. And Noelle, both of the speakers spoke to it earlier, which is so much of this next generation of technology is really reliant on subject matter experts. So, and we have subject matter experts in New York City.
Right.
And in the creative space,
right,
particularly, right? So what's exciting is to make sure that we're bringing all of these various stakeholders and providing them opportunities to learn from one another, to cross-pollinate, to understand use cases, and to begin to build the infrastructure, right? We talk about standards. If we talk about virtual reality as potentially curing or treating PTSD, shouldn't we be asking if it can cause it and what might that mean? If we are a community of creators, which we are, all of these skills are critically important once you understand and learn about the enabling technology, not just in entertainment and media, but also in healthcare. They are dying over there for you, some of you UX people or you graphic artists, because they need to build content. And the type of content that you build in a virtual world or an augmented world is really different than the type of content that you build for other things. So you need artists and creatives who don't think in the same 2D, in the same notion of time and space as many others do. So there's just a tremendous opportunity here in New York City for many, many reasons. And I think what we're most hopeful is that we find a way where we're systematically building, creating building blocks so that these various industries and these various the people with these various skill sets understand what the potential opportunity is in the short term and in the long term.
Super interesting. And you know, that sort of leads directly to my next question is how do, not just you, I'd say we, and I would like the city to lead in this, of course, you know, how do we make sure that we're building responsible stuff, right? So that's the thread throughout what we've heard this morning, what we're probably going to hear throughout today and tomorrow. Yes, technology. Yes, we're building all this stuff. Obviously, we've seen lately, you know, in the news how wrong stuff can go. And
you mean just that op-ed in the New York Times by the co-founder of that big social media company?
Yes, yes.
Talking about that?
Yes, yes. Just for one. You know, last night, Mark Thomas at NYC EDC mentioned EDC just put out an RFEI for an AI ethics center for the city. I mean, I thought RLab, I thought when they put out, you know, the RFEI for RLab, that was, you know, super, the future, oh my God, New York. That's really an amazing thing. I would love for New York to lead in the ethical part of all this technology, right? I think we've led in the creative part, but how are you guys thinking about that at RLab and just sort of generally, how should we all be thinking about it?
I'm sorry, every time I start thinking about all these ethic issues, my body just cramps up. I want to make a quick point. That slide that we're looking at, this is how we're sort of thinking about, because I'm going to get to the impact, because this is a really important question, and I'm really glad you asked. We're thinking about these immersive technologies, RLab Well, which is health and medicine and wellness. There's a lot happening there. Some medical schools are even getting rid of cadavers, and they're using virtual simulations and VR applications. The second bucket would be heavy industries, training, smart cities, all sorts of immersive smart buildings and those sorts of applications. The third one, obviously, we're in New York City. We're all about media, creatives. Many of you probably work in the industry. And it's changing a lot, right? And we've, for example, been very, very involved in the Broadway Accelerator. I'm so excited about how Sherbert organization and Kyle Wright and his team are just really leading this notion of innovation and what that means for live entertainment and for Broadway.
So you guys know this? This is a little indie fact. So the Schubert Theater here in New York on Broadway that really runs a lot of the ticketing for most of the shows, they're doing a tech accelerator, which is just, I mean, that's so full circle for me as a New Yorker. Tech and theater were always really separate in my mind. So you know, I think that's super exciting.
Yeah, it's good times. It's really definitely good times. They've had a lot of great applications, and we're going to sit down and look at them on Monday and pick some companies
that will
be invested in. Oh, good. I'll see you Monday. And the last bucket, so media and entertainment and all of that, and games and e-commerce and so on. And the last one we feel really strongly about, which is RLab Impact. And those, we believe that we have an opportunity to surface up some of those questions that are really important about what's the impact to society and to culture. And how do we start talking about the things that we're making when we actually have no idea exactly how VR potentially affects the brain, right? And we're working on those things. But we need to be talking about them in broad ways, because the question becomes, who decides? Or how, what are the standards and the mechanisms by which those issues are considered? What does that look like? What's ethical VR? I don't know. And I would dare somebody to come here and talk about what that is, because they don't know either. There's a bunch of opinions about these things. And I'm also a maker, as you know, as sitting in front of creators. I mean, I'm a maker. I'm a producer at heart. I worked in television for a long time. And I'm really a storyteller, even though I've also been a tax lawyer and other things. So yes, don't follow my career path. it's not a straight line. But the point is just that making, you know, VR, making AR, making these immersive technologies is really complicated. But what sorts of questions do we need to be asking ourselves that are different than when we're making a 2D, a film, or a documentary, or other types of visual content? So it's really, it's critically important, because I think we've seen what happens when we don't ask those questions. And we need a broad swath of stakeholders to be having those conversations, investors and academics and founders and makers and so on and so forth, who are engaging. So I think that's fantastic about the AI Center, because obviously AI is, as one of my best friends says, Tiffany Norwood, who is a serial entrepreneur, it triggers the excitanic. It's sort of exciting and also panic, because you know, the potential for the wrong outcomes in AI are so rampant. And so we really want to be vigilant, right, and thinking about these things through as a community.
Right, right, totally. I just wanted to be able, you know, one of the reasons why I wanted to have Adaora in a chat situation is so that, you know, I could also engage all of you. Maybe we have time for one question, one or two questions. Does anyone have a question for Adaora or about RLab that you want to ask? I mean, she and I can certainly go on and talk about lots of stuff if you
there
don't.
There's not a single person in this entire place.
Right over here.
Hi there. Thank you, folks, for the chat. My name is Danielle. I'm actually not a New Yorker. I'm from Toronto, Canada. So I wanted to know how RLabs is leveraging all the amazing work that you guys are doing for other cities.
I love that question so much, and let me tell you why. As was noted earlier, none of this technology is new. The work on VR and AR and all of these things has been going on for many, many, many decades, and it's been happening globally. I mean, I think one of the reasons why we talk about this next evolution of technology, like maybe not being so centered in Silicon Valley, is because there's so many different types of technology, and there's so much incredible work that's been happening all over the world and on all continents. When I worked for a venture firm, we were investing in these companies, and they were invested in companies in Africa and in Asia and in the Middle East and Europe and in North America. So it's very broad, and it's interesting that you asked that question. Even though RLab's only been, the doors have just been open for a few months, the incoming internationally is spectacular. I mean, I think I've had representatives from just about, you know, at least one country in every continent, their consulates, and in many continents, multiples, right? So we are trying to, again, serve as a beacon, both here in New York City, but also globally. It's like, if you're interested in immersive tech and you want to know what's happening and you want to meet vendors, or you've got some interesting technology or you've got some interesting research, come see us. We are literally trying to serve as
so just let it, as an ending note, how do we all get involved? Adaora, what do? You want us to sign up at the website to get the newsletters?
We want you to go to rlab.nyc and sign up for the newsletter, just like Dawn said.
rlab.nyc. Thank you so much, Adaora Udoji.